好，弟兄姊妹平安。感谢主，又在这样一个美好的主日，让我们在这里聚集。我们今天一起来分享的是《利未记》第26章。
We are sharing together Leviticus chapter 26.
转眼《利未记》就要结束了。
In a flash, Leviticus is ending.
利未记26章呢，是倒数第二章。
Leviticus chapter 26 is the second to last chapter.
今天的这段经文呢，我给它起的题目叫做恩上加恩。
Today's topic is grace upon grace.
我们人在日常生活中，我们常常喜欢用如果这个词。
In our daily lives, we often like to use word if.
我们教育我们孩子的时候经常会说。
When we talk to our children, we will say,
你如果好好吃饭，吃完饭就给你个冰激凌。
If you finish your food, you will have ice cream afterwards.
如果你不好好收玩具，待会儿不能看电视。
If you don't clean up, you won't be able to watch TV.
我们当中如果有做过销售的弟兄姊妹们，可能都有这样的经历。
If any brothers and sisters have ever been in sales, you would know.
老板呢，每个月都给你定一个销售目标。
And every month, your boss will give you a sales target.
如果你能达标
，If you reach that target,
奖金就翻倍。
Your bonus will double.
如果连着几个月不达标
，If you do not hit your target in consecutive months，
那怎么办呢
？What happens？
卷铺盖走人。
You'll be fired。
今天在利未记的26章里面
，In Leviticus chapter 26 today，
如果这个词呢，也是出现了好多好多次。
The word if appeared many many times。
当然，圣经比较文雅，圣经用的是若。
But the Bible is more eloquent. It's used the word on the condition of.
若这个词呢，在利未记二十六章的中文版本中呢，出现了七次。
The word on the condition of in the Chinese translation appears seven times.
但是因为翻译的原因呢，英文的 if 出现的次数更多。
But because of the translation in the English version, the word if appeared more.
If 这个词呢，一共出现了十次。
The word if appeared 10 times in English.
所以我们弟兄姊妹如果之前没有读过利未记二十六章的话
，So if you have never read Leviticus chapter 26,
你第一次读
，and this is your first time reading it,
你也觉得神在这儿开始给我们定规矩。
You must think that the God here is setting up rules.
神一定在说，你遵守我的律例和典章。
You would think that God saying, if you comply,
我就赐福。
If you comply to my commandments, I will bless you.
如果你不听我的
If you do not comply,
我就降各种各样的灾来击打你
I will give you all sorts of woes.
各种各样的惩罚
All sorts of punishment.
那简而言之呢
So to put it simply,
这就是顺我者昌，逆我者亡
It's let those who comply prosper, let those who resist perish.
我想如果之前没有读过利未记二十六章的弟兄姊妹们，可能这是你的第一印象。
I would think this is your first impression of Leviticus chapter 26 if you have never read it.
但是你这个第一印象跟我的题目恩上加恩好像有点对不上号。
But if this is your first impression, it would not fit my topic today, grace upon grace.
但是咱俩理解谁对呢
？But whose understanding is correct one?
我们一起来看一下前后文。
Let's read the chapter in context.
我们简单回顾一下利未记前二十五章。
Let's think back to the first 25 chapters in Leviticus.
利未记前二十五章中，你们最有印象的两个大概念是什么
？What's the main two things that you have taken away from the first 25 chapters?
一个应该是献祭。
The first would be offerings.
另外一个应该是节期。
And the second thing would be feasts.
神设立了五个祭。
God set up five offerings.
神设立这五个祭不是五个仪式啊。
These five offerings are not just rituals.
神设立这五个祭是为了让人能够来亲近他。
But God set up these five offerings so that men can be close to God.
他为人开了一条道路，人能够来到神的面前。
God set up a path so that men can come before Him.
所以说，这个在新约里面我们称为称义。
In the New Testament, we call this justification.
我们还记得那另外那七个节期。
Do we remember the seven feasts?
这七个节期的设立
And the seven feasts
神为了让我们能够在它里面有安息
is set up so that man can have rest in God.
这样人呢可以持续地活在神的面光当中
so that man can continuously live before God.
人可以过圣洁的生活
and they can live a holy life.
这就像我们在新约中所说的
So this is what we call in the New Testament.
待到基督再来时，我们和他共享荣耀。
In the second coming of Christ, we will joy in Lord's glory.
所以说，我们回顾了前25章以后。
So after we have looked at the first 25 chapters.
我们发现神是想尽了办法让我们能够来到他的面前。
We can see that God used all sorts of methods so that man can come before him.
他想让我们在他里面有安息。
God wants us to have peace in him and rest in him.
他想让我们能够过圣洁的生活。
God wants us to be able to live holy before him.
但是到了26章。
But when we come to chapter 26,
变成了顺我者昌，逆我者亡。
It all of a sudden becomes, let those who comply prosper and those who resist perish.
你不觉得不合理吗？
Don't you think that's unreasonable?
所以我们一起来看一看26章。
So let's read chapter 26 together.
看看这里圣经想让我们展示神怎样的性情。
Let us see what exactly this chapter is trying to reveal to us.
26章呢，我把它分为四个段落。
In chapter 26, I have divided it into four parts.
一到二节，我给它起的小标题叫做“我是耶和华”。
Verse 1 to 2, it's I am Jehovah.
三到十三节呢，是顺命者得福。
Verse 3 to 13 is blessing for the obedient.
十四到三十九节是挽回逆命者。
Verse 14 to 39, it's redeeming the disobedient.
四十到四十六节。
In verse 40 to 46,
小标题是守约是慈爱。
And the topic would be faithfulness and mercifulness.
我们先来看一到二节。
Let's read verse 1 to 2.
第一节说：“你们不可做什么虚无的神像，不可立雕刻的偶像或是柱像，也不可在你们的地上安什么虔诚的石像，向他跪拜，因为我是耶和华你们的神。你们要守我的安息日，进我的圣所。我是耶和华。”
You shall not make idols for yourselves, or erect an image or pillar, and you shall not set up a figure stone in your land to bow down to it. For I am the Lord your God. You shall keep my Sabbath and reverence my sanctuary. I am the Lord.
这里呢，基本上是对十诫的前半部分的一个重复。
Here, this is basically a repeat of what was said in the Ten Commandments.
他提到了不可有别的神。
It says that you shall not have other gods.
不可雕刻偶像。
And you shall not worship false idol.
最后说呢，要守安息日。
And lastly, says keeping the Sabbath.
这样子的概念呢，在摩西的五经中呢，重复了很多次。
These concepts were repeated several times in books of Moses.
在利未记里面呢，已经第二次提到了。
And even in Leviticus, this is the second time it's mentioned.
我们想是不是神记性不好，忘记他以前说过这个了
？Do you think God is forgetful that He forgot He already said this？
我每天对我们家小孩说的最多的是：“你们要好好吃饭。”
Every day I say to my kids several times a day that eat your food。
有时候我一天甚至要说好多次。
And sometimes I would have to say it a lot of times, repeat myself every day。
是因为我忘记我之前刚刚讲过吗
？Is it because I forgot I just said it？
当然不是。
Of course not。
因为我所讲话的对象都是不好好吃饭的主人。
It's because they don't eat their food.
我们如果知道一点以色列历史，
If we know about the Israelites' history,
我们知道这些百姓们嘛，从上到下呢，常常干翻身。
We know that these people, throughout their entire nation, they often sin.
他们也常常受神的管教。
And they are often disciplined by God.
而这些干翻神，大多数的时候呢，都是因为他们拜偶像。他们不把神当神。
And most of the times, their transgressions is that they do, they worship false idol and they don't treat God as their Lord.
所以说，神在这里再次强调这几个概念。
So here, God emphasized these points again and again.
在这里呢，不管是一还是二节中呢，都提到了我是耶和华。
In here, in verse 1 and 2, it mentions I am Jehovah.
这也是二十六章里面最重要的一句话。
And this is the most important sentence in chapter 26.
他告诉我们呢，因为神的所是。
Here it tells us because of who God is.
他就要赐福给那些顺服他的人。
God will bless the obedient.
他也要挽回那些背逆他的人。
And He will redeem the disobedient.
神是要人来认识他，来亲近他。
God wants its people to come to know Him and be close to Him.
他也要他的民同住同行。
He also wants to dwell with His people and walk with His people.
我们来看三到十三节。
And let's read verse 3 to 13.
三到十三节呢，小标题是顺命者得福。
In verse 3 to 13, the topic is blessing for the obedient.
我们想想一下这个概念呢，其实非常的合理。
If we think about this concept, it's very reasonable.
我们不管是我们的下属也好，还是我们的孩子也好，听话的时候，我们都想把好的东西给他们。
And no matter is your subordinates or your children, when they're obedient, you want to bless them and give them good things.
神也有这样的心意。
God also has such a blessing.
而且他想把他最好的东西都给这些顺服的人。
And God wants to give His best blessings to those who are obedient.
我们一起来读第四到五节。
Let's read verse 4 and 5.
这是当人遵守神的律例的时候，神要给他们的。
This is the blessing God bestows upon men when they are obedient.
第四节说：“我就给你们降下时雨，叫地生出土产，田野的树木结果子。”你们打粮食要打到摘葡萄的时候，摘葡萄要摘到撒种的时候，并且要吃得饱足，在你们地上安然居住。
Then I will give you your rains in their season, and the land shall yield its increase, and the trees of the field shall yield their fruit. Your threshing shall last to the time of the grape harvest, and the grape harvest shall last the time for sowing. And you shall eat your bread to the full, and dwell in your land securely.
这是神对以色列百姓最需要的东西，食物的祝福。
This is a blessing that's most important to the Israelites. It's a blessing in their food and produce.
这里呢，其实是一个预言性的祝福。
This blessing is actually a prophecy.
为什么呢
？And why is that?
因为神在颁布利未记这里的时候呢，百姓们还在旷野。
Because when this was written for the Israelite people, they were still in the wilderness.
他们吃的还是玛拿
，They were still eating manna，
并谈不上什么土特产。
They're not even thinking about land produce yet。
但是当他们到了迦南地以后
，But when they reached the land of Canaan，
玛拿的供应就停了
，The manna will stop。
他们就需要考虑耕种收割
，And they will have to think about sowing seeds and harvesting。
神就要祝福他们
，But God will bless them。
神祝福他们有大丰收
，God bless them with great harvest。
我们从经文里可以看到
，We can see in this verse，
以色列的百姓呢，那个时候呢，最多的收的是大麦、小麦还有葡萄。
The main crops for the Israelite people at that time were wheat, barley, and grapes.
那你如果知道一点农业啊，那个时候是农业。
If you know about forestry at that time，
以色列百姓呢是四月份收大麦的。
The Israelites harvest barley in April.
他们在六月呢收小麦
，and they harvest wheat in June。
然后呢，他们七月收葡萄
，and then they harvest grapes in July。
然后十月份撒种
，and then they sow their seeds in October。
神在这里说，你们打粮食要打到摘葡萄，摘葡萄要摘到撒种。
And here God says, your threshing shall last to the time of the grape harvest, and the grape harvest shall last the time for sowing。
所以说神要祝福他们呢，从四月到十月都不停地在丰收。
So God is blessing them with continuous harvest from April all the way to October.
这是一个多美的画面。
And what a beautiful picture.
还不仅如此。
And not only this.
我们来读六到八节。
Let's read verse 6 to 8.
我要赐平安在你们的地上，你们躺卧无人惊吓。我要叫恶兽从你们的地上熄灭，刀剑也必不经过你们的地。你们要追赶仇敌，他们必倒在你们刀下。你们五个人要追赶一百人，一百人要追赶一万人，仇敌必倒在你们刀下。
I will give you peace in the land, and you shall lie down, and none shall make you afraid. And I will remove harmful beasts from the land, and the sword shall not go through your land. You shall chase your enemies, and they shall fall before you by the sword. Five of you shall chase 100, and 100 of you shall chase 10,000, and your enemies shall fall before you by the sword.
所以说，神在这里在赐福给百姓他们的丰收以后。
So here, when we look at after Lord has blessed its people with harvest,
神要赐给百姓这些平安。
God is blessing these His people with peace.
在那个战乱的年代。
In the time of war,
平安呢？不仅仅是他们在自己土地上的平安
，peace does not only mean security on your land，
还代表着他们能够打胜仗。
It also means they can be victorious。
神在这里实在祝福他们。
The Lord has greatly blessed them today。
第八节说，他们五个人要追赶一百人，一百人要追赶一万人。
In verse 8, it says, five of you shall chase 100, and 100 of you shall chase 10,000.
我们弟兄姊妹最熟悉的可能就是约书亚记里面他们攻占耶利哥城的例子。
I think you all be familiar with the story in the book of Joshua of the city of Jericho.
不伤一兵一卒。
Where the Israelites did not have a single casualty.
就能攻占一个城。
And they were victorious in the city of Jericho.
这实在是神极大的祝福。
And that was a great blessing from God.
还不仅如此。
But even furthermore.
神在第九节说，我要眷顾你们，使你们生养众多，也要与你们坚定所立的约。
In verse 9 it says, I will turn to you and make you fruitful and multiply you, and will confirm my covenant with you.
生养众多呢，是神在这里给以色列当时更大的一个祝福。
Being fruitful and multiply is even greater blessing for the Israelites.
这是非常宝贵的，在那个年代。
This is very precious at that time.
从他们这个民族的经济发展来讲。
From an economic growth point of view.
人口的增长是经济发展最重要的一个因素。
A population increase is key to economic growth.
我们看当今世界上。
If we look at modern day.
经济发展最快的国家或者地区呢，都是人口增长最快的。
Those countries that grow in their economy all have an increase in their population.
我们知道日本的经济非常发达。
We know that Japan has a very developed economy.
但是因为在过去的二十年中人口不增长。
But because it has stopped increasing its population in the last two decades.
他们的经济呢也就停在那里，原地踏步。
Their economy became stale.
那从军事的角度来讲呢？
And in a military perspective,
在那个打仗的年代啊,
in that time of war,
人口是一个非常重要的因素。
Population is a key.
人多的国家在打仗的过程中才有保障。
Those who have a more population, those nations will have more protection in a time of war.
所以神要在这里祝福他们生养众多。
So here, God will bless them with fruitfulness and multiply number.
让他们能够在人口上有保障。
So that they can have security in their population.
所以我们看从第三到第十节。
So here we see from verse 3 to 10.
当然第十节也是对他们这个收成上的一个祝福。
And verse 10 is also a blessing towards their produce.
所以说从第三到第十节。
So from verse 3 to 10.
神要祝福他们有丰收。
God will bless them with great harvest.
有平安。
With peace.
人口要生养众多。
With a multiply in number and fruitfulness.
我们总结来呢，就是风调雨顺，国泰民安。
And we put all this together, this is giving them good weather, fruitfulness, a strong nation, peace and solidarity.
这是历世历代所有国家所求的呀。
This is what every nation throughout the history has been asking for.
你看那些中国古代皇帝登基的时候
，And if you look at in the Chinese dynasty when every emperor ascends its throne，
他们办很大的仪式要来祭祖
，They put a great ritual for ancestral worship。
那新皇帝在烧香拜的时候，他心里想的是什么
？And what does the emperor pray for when he's praying？
除了保住我的王位以外
，Other than keeping my own throne，
就是风调雨顺，国泰民安。
He is praying for the good weather, fruitfulness, a strong nation, peace and solidarity.
所以说神在这里给以色列的祝福呢?
So here, God is blessing the Israelites.
难道仅仅停留在我们历朝历代皇帝们拜祖所求的吗?
Is he blessing the Israelites with the same thing that those emperors have been worshipping for?
和他们那些人拜偶像所求的难道是一样的吗?
Is it the same with those who have been worshipping false idols?
我们来看十一节。
Let's read verse 11.
十一节说，我要在你们中间立我的帐幕，我的心也不厌恶你们。
Verse 11 says, I will make my dwelling among you, and my soul shall not abhor you.
这是什么意思?
What does that mean?
神要把他的家安在百姓当中。
God is going to place his home, his house, and he will dwell among his people.
每当我们想到神的时候
，And every time we think of deity,
我们因为文化的原因，我们觉得神是高高在上的。
Because of our culture, we think a deity is all the way high up.
就算是那些假神、那些偶像们
，Even those false idols,
要么住在山顶
，There are always high up in the mountain.
或者是深山老林里面。
Or they're hidden in a deep forest.
人想朝拜呢，要费老鼻子劲。
If someone wants to pay a tribute, they have to break an arm and a leg.
那些越大的住的越偏。
The higher the deity, the further hidden they are.
但是我们这位真神。
But this true living God.
他要把他自己的居所安在百姓当中。
He will make his home and dwelling among his people.
这是我们在其他地方听都没听过的。
This is unheard of.
还不仅如此。
And furthermore.
十二节说，我要在你们中间行走，我要做你们的神，你们要做我的子民。
In verse 12 it says, And I will walk among you and will be your God, and you shall be my people.
这里说到神主动选择了百姓做他的子民。
Here it said God initiated and he chose these people to be his people.
这都不是百姓自己求来的。
This is not even something that people prayed for.
而且呢，他要在你们中间行走。
And also, he will walk with his people.
他要与百姓同行。
He will walk among them.
百姓去哪里
？Wherever these people go,
神就去哪里。
God will be there.
他要做百姓随时的帮助。
He will be their strength always.
而且神在做这些预言的时候，他并不是空口无凭。
And when God made these promises, these are not empty promises.
十三节告诉我们说，我是耶和华你们的神，曾将你们从埃及地领出来，使你们不做埃及人的奴仆。我也折断你们所负的轭，叫你们挺身而走。
In verse 13, it says, I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, that you should not be their slaves, and I have broken the bars of your yoke and made you walk erect.
神说，我不仅要这样祝福你们啊。
God said, not only am I going to bless you.
你们记住，我已经把你们从埃及为奴的身份领出来了。
Remember, I have already released you from slavery in Egypt.
我已经为你做了这个事情了。
I already done this for you.
所以说，我现在要将来要给你们祝福，我不是空口无凭，我是有凭据的。
So the future blessing that I have just said is not an empty promise. I have already done great deeds.
所以我们看到。当百姓顺服神的时候
，So here we see when the people are obedient，
神要给他们极大的祝福
，God will give them great blessings，
神要给他们丰收
，God will give them harvest，
神要给他们平安
，God will give them peace，
神要给他们生养众多
，God will give them increase in number，
神还要住在他们当中
，God will also dwell among them，
与他们同住同行。
And God will dwell among them and walk with them.
这是何等好的一个神呢
？What a wonderful picture!
当然，在这里有一个概念我们需要强调。
But here, there's a concept we must emphasize.
就是神在这里的祝福呢，都是一个团体的概念。
Here, God's blessing is a group concept.
不是一个或者两个以色列百姓顺服神，神就立刻祝福这一到两个百姓。
It's not one or two Israelite individuals. They become obedient, and then God will bless these few individuals.
神盼望整个以色列民族的顺服。
God is hoping for a nation, Israel nation, to be obedient as a whole.
他也盼望给把他的祝福给这整个民族。
God will also is also hoping to bless the Israel nation as a whole.
我们看十四到三十九节。
Let's read verse 14 to 39.
我们起的标题是挽回逆命者。
Here the topic is redeeming the disobedient.
我们知道任何事情呢都有两个方面。
We know that there are two sides to a coin.
当百姓顺服神的时候
，When the people are obedient to God,
神赐福给他们
，God will bless them.
当百姓悖逆的时候
，And when people are disobedient,
神也要伸手来管教他们
，God will reach out His hand to discipline them.
神的管教在这里并不是惩罚
，God's discipline here is not a punishment,
而是挽回
，but a redeeming factor.
为什么这么讲呢？
Why do we say that?
因为你们有没有发现，这里管教的经文十四到三十九节有二十六节。
We see that in the verse of disciplining, it's 14 to 39. It's 26 verses.
真的很长。
It's very long.
如果你还看之前祝福的经文呢，是三到十三节。
And if you look at the verses for blessing, is verse 3 to 13.
那是十节。
It's 10 verses.
你比较这个文字的量啊。
If you compare the amount of the scripture.
好像感觉管教比祝福要多太多了。
It seems like that discipline is so, so much more than blessings.
但是呢，岂不知神在这里的管教呢，是因为它是层层递进的。
But here, in actuality, it's because discipline is progressing step by step.
我们一起来看这一段。
Let's read this passage.
我们来读十四到十七节。
Let's read verse 14 to 17.
十四节说：“你们若不听从我，不遵行我的诫命，厌弃我的律例，厌恶我的典章，不遵行我一切的诫命，背弃我的约，我待你们就要这样。我必命定金黄，叫眼目干瘪，精神消损的痨病、热病辖管你们。你们也要白白撒种，因为仇敌要吃你们所种的。我要向你们变脸，你们就要败在仇敌面前。恨恶你们的必辖管你们，无人追赶，你们却要逃跑。
But if you will not listen to me and will not do all these commands, if you spurn my statutes and if your soul abhors my rules, so that you will not do all my commandments and break my covenant, then I will do this to you. I will visit you with panic.With wasting disease and fever that consumes the eyes and make the heart ache. And you shall sow your seeds in vain, for your enemies shall eat it. I will set my face against you, and you shall be struck down before your enemies. Those who hate you shall rule over you, and you shall flee when none pursues you.
这是呢，第一步的管教。
This is the first step in God's discipline.
虽然我们看这个经文很长。
Although this passage is long,
但是这个管教呢，其实非常皮毛的。
This discipline is rather superficial.
这里提到了好几种方式。
Here we see quite a few different methods.
我们看神说要让痨病和热病来辖制百姓。
Here we see that there is a wasting disease and fever that consumes the eye and make the heart ache.
这只是身体上的一些不舒服。
This is a physical discomfort.
他们要白白撒种呢，仇敌要吃他们所种的。
And they will sow in vain because their enemies shall eat it.
这只是生活上的不便利。
This is an inconvenience in life.
就像有一个自然灾害一样而已。
It's almost like a natural disaster.
就算是他们要败在仇敌面前。
And even when they will fall before their enemies.
这个呢也是一时的败仗。
This is a temporary defeat.
毕竟在那个年代，胜败乃兵家常事。
In that warring time, defeat and triumph are usual.
神的这些管教呢，只是皮毛。
This discipline is rather superficial.
并不是致命的。
It's not threatening.
但是如果以色列的百姓这个时候能知道神的管教
，But if the Israelite people knows that God is disciplining them,
他能够接受神的管教
，They will accept and make amends.
悔改。
They will repent.
神的管教到此为止啊。
Then God's discipline will stop here.
神会用继续用慈爱和怜悯来待他们。
God will receive them with grace and mercy.
但是如果他们硬着景象继续背逆神。
But if they're strong-headed and continues to disobey God.
神的管教就会继续。
God's discipline will continue.
十八节。
In verse 18.
你们因这些事若不听从我，我就要为你们的罪加七倍惩罚你们。十九节，我必断绝你们因势力而有的骄傲，又要使负你们的天如铁，宰你们的地如铜。二十节，你们要白白的劳力，因为你们的地不出土产，其上的树木也不结果子。
18 to 20, and if in spite of this you will not listen to me, then I will discipline you again sevenfold for your sins, and I will break the pride of your power, and I will make your heavens like iron, your earth like bronze, and your strength will be spent in vain, for your land shall not yield its increase, the trees of the land shall not yield their fruit.
这是神第二步的管教。
This is a second step in God's discipline.
我们看第二步好像就比第一步稍微严重了一点。
And we can see that the second step is more severe than the first.
第一步呢就是一些不舒服不便利。
The first step is an inconvenience and discomfort.
第二步好像神开始慢慢的动真格了。
The second step it seems like God is serious about this.
这里说他们的天如铁。
Here it says their heavens is like iron.
就是天干的呀不下雨。
It's like the heaven is so dry, there's no rain.
地如铜
and the earth like bronze.
地干的呀，不出产
and the earth is parched, so there's no produce.
他们要，神要加给他们七倍的惩罚
God will discipline them sevenfold for their sins.
这个七就代表是完全的惩罚
and seven here resembles the completeness of the discipline.
所以我们看到在这里呢，这就这个这第二步的管教呢，就稍微严重了一点。
So we see the second discipline is more serious.
不是简单的不舒服。
It's not a discomfort.
它开始影响到了以色列百姓的生计。
It's affecting the Israelites' livelihood.
这个时候呢，他们也可以百姓们可以选择接受管教。
And here, Israelites can receive the discipline.
或者拒绝。
Or reject the discipline.
我们来看第三步。
And let's see what happens in the third step.
22节说，我也要打发野地的走兽到你们中间，抢吃你们的儿女，吞灭你们的牲畜，使你们的人数减少，道路荒凉。
In verse 22, I will let loose the wild beasts against you, which shall bereave you of your children and destroy your livestock and make you few in number, so that your roads shall be deserted.
我看前两步啊，都只是粮食不出产啊，有点小病啊。
The first two steps is that they will have disease and they will reduce their livestock, they will reduce their produce.
第三步呢，开始吃人了。
But the third step, their people are being devoured.
他们的人口要减少。
They will decrease in their number.
这个民族要受神的打击。
This whole nation's existence is being threatened.
他们的存亡都受到了一定的威胁。
The fact of their existence is being threatened.
这个时候他们还是有机会回头的。
But even at this step, they have the opportunity to return.
但是如果不回头。
But if they do not repent,
神还有第四步。
God has the fourth step.
第四步是23-26节。
The fourth step is verse 23-26.
23节告诉我们说，你们因这事若仍不悔改归我，行事与我反对。
23 says, and if by this discipline you are not turned to me, but walk contrary to me.
神的意思是都到这一步了，你还不听。
What God says here is that we're now at this step, and you are still not listening to me.
野兽都开始吃你的儿女了。
The beasts are eating up your children.
还不听。
And you're still not listening.
来，我要25节说，我又要使刀剑临到你们，降瘟疫在你们中间，就是断绝你们的粮。
And here in verse 25, it says, I will bring a sword upon you that shall execute vengeance for the covenant. And if you gather within your cities, I will send pestilence among you, and you shall be delivered into the hands of your enemy.
神要降下刀剑就是战争。
And God will bring sword, that means war.
接下来还有瘟疫。
And follows is plague.
还有饥荒。
And then it's famine.
我们看第26节说，十个女人在一个炉子烤饼的这个画面。
We see in verse 26 a picture of 10 women baking in a single oven.
就是在战争、瘟疫和饥荒交集的时候。
This is a picture amongst war, plague, and famine.
以色列百姓的一个惨淡的景象。
This is the bleak picture, a very bleak picture for the Israelites.
就算在这样的时候，神还是给他们机会悔改。
And even at this time, God still gives them an opportunity.To repent.
但是如果他们选择不悔改，
But if they choose to not to repent,
我们来看27-39节，神的第五步。
Let's see verse 27-39, God's fifth step.
这是也是最后的一步。
And this is the final step.
我们弟兄姊妹都想了，之前有战争、瘟疫和饥荒了，神你还能怎样？
So we would think that there were war, plague, and famine. What else can you do, God?
我们读历史书的时候，可能这就是最严重的了。
And when we read in history books, this is probably the worst that could happen.
但是就算是这战争、瘟疫、饥荒，以色列百姓好像还是不悔改。
But even under war, plague, and famine, the Israelites will not repent.
神在28节里面说。
In verse 28.
神就要说，我就要发烈怒，行事与你们反对。
Then I will walk contrary to you in fury.
神要发烈怒啊。
God will come down in fury.
因为接下来的都是一些无法挽回的伤害。
Because what follows is irreversible damage.
他要把百姓原本的土地都变为荒场。
God will lay desolation to their land.
那些在这个整个管教过程中还没有被击杀的百姓，也要被流落在列邦。
And all those people that actually survived the wars will scatter among the nation.
就算到了列邦当中。
And even when they're scattered among the nation.
这些百姓还要继续受苦。
These people will continue to suffer.
因为神说他们要在仇敌之地心惊胆战。
Because God said they will have faint-hearted in the land of enemy.
他们要在列邦中灭亡。
And they will perish among the nation.
他们要在仇敌之地消失。
And they will be extinct in their land of in the land of their enemies.
这是神终极的管教。
This is God's ultimate discipline.
太惨了。
This is very cruel.
虽然这样子管教非常的严酷。
Even though this discipline seems rather cruel.
但是我们看到在这个过程中神不断给人的机会。
But we see that in this process, God continues to give people opportunities.
第一步，第二步。
The first step and the second step.
在他们身体不舒服的时候。
When they are feeling discomfort in their physical form.
在他们田里不长的时候。
When they're having reproduce decrease.
只要他们认罪悔改
as soon as they repent and confess,
回到神的面前
they return before God,
神的管教到此为止
God's discipline will stop.
但是很可惜的是
but unfortunately,
以色列民族
Israelite nation,
就是这样一次一次的不悔改
they are unwilling to repent over and over again.
他不停地挑战神的底线
they keep on pushing God's bottom line.
他们好像就想要看看
It's almost like they want to see.
哎，神，你还能干啥
？God, what do you? What else can you do?
我们都已经饥荒战争了。
We're having war and famine and plague.
我们都已经战乱了。
We're having all this chaos.
还能咋样
？What else could you do?
他们最后被仇敌吞灭。
But in the end, they are devoured by their enemy.
百姓被抓被掳。
The people are kidnapped and killed.
散落在巴比伦。
And scattered in Babylon.
我们不禁问自己啊。
We would ask ourselves.
这样的神是这样一个严酷的神。
Is our God so cruel?
他到底还爱不爱百姓们
？Does he really love the Israelite people?
我们从我们自己身上找答案。
We can find the answer on ourselves.
我想我们当中做父母的弟兄姊妹们都有管教儿女的经验。
I think those of us who are parents would know we have the experience in teaching our children.
我们常常是正面的劝导。和反面的管教相呼应。
We often have a positive guidance and reinforcement in disciplining.
我们常常用一些励志的故事呢，来劝导我们的孩子。
We often try to guide our children with positive examples and stories.
让他们走正路。
So that they can walk on a righteous path.
让他们有道德。
So that they can have morals.
让他们有信仰。
So that they can have faith.
但是有时候呢，我们也不得不。管教他们。
But sometimes we would have to resort to discipline.
这个时候呢，还有一些丧心病狂的父母呢，说打是亲，骂是爱。
And here some cruel parents would yell out, loving rod, beating in with rod in the name of love.
你管教就算了。
It's fine if you discipline them.
你还边管教边洗脑。
You would discipline them with rod and then you try to brainwash them.
我小时候呢，就是打是亲骂是爱的对象。
I was the subject of beating with rods in the name of love.
有时候我爸管教我。
So when I was kids, I was disciplined by my dad.
他说我是爱你。
He said, I love you.
我就一把鼻子一把泪的跟他说。
I would in tears, I would tell him.
我说爸。
Dad.
你先爱自己吧。
Why don't you love yourself first?
结果呢
？What happens？
结果就是更多的爱临到我，对不对
？More love fell upon me.
但是，不得不说
，But still we have to admit，
父母管教儿子儿女的时候，大多的情况下都是因着爱。
When parents discipline their children, at most times it's because of love.
我爸那时候会说一句话
，My dad would say，
我怎么不去管人街上小孩呢
？Why don't I discipline those kids on the street？
我说你试试啊。
I was like, why don't you try？
父母管教儿女大部分都是因着爱。
So parents discipline their kids because of love.
所以说我们管教孩子的方式呢，也是像神管教以色列百姓一样。
The way we teach and discipline our children is almost similar to the way God disciplines Israelites.
我们是一步一步递进的，对不对
？We progress in steps.
我们先是好言好语的说教。
We would start with gentle speech.
我们希望我们能够摆事实讲道理，能够感化我们的儿女。
We hope we would lay out the facts and reason with them.
然后第二步呢，我们可能会对他自由做一些限制。
And then what follows is a little constraint on their freedom.
不准看电视。
You can't watch TV.
不准用电脑。
You can't use computer.
不准出去玩。
You are grounded.
只有到这些儿女们一而再、再而三地犯相同的错误。
It's only when these kids they repeat their same mistakes over and over again.
而且这个错的比较严重、比较离谱的时候。
And these mistakes are very serious ones.
我们才会使用这些比较严厉的方式。
We will resort to a more severe discipline.
在这个过程中，我们期待什么？
What are we hoping in this process, in these steps?
我最期待的是，当我给他摆事实、讲道理的时候，他就认识到自己错误了。
I was hoping when I started laying out the facts and start reasoning with them, they would realize their mistakes.
他就改过来了。
They will return and repent.
我根本就不需要到这个打气、骂晒的环节，对不对
？I won't have to resort to rod in the name of love.
因为就算你打孩子。
And so even if you come to the point with rods,
疼在孩子身上
it hurts on them physically.
做父母的心里疼不疼
But it also hurts in the parents' heart.
也疼啊
It hurts.
我们知道神对我们人的爱是超过世上所有的爱的
We know that God's love for man far exceeds any love on earth.
我们对我们的儿女尚且如此
We treat our own children as such.
神对我们又尚且不是这样呢
？How much more so is God's love towards us？
神管教以色列百姓
，When God disciplines the Israelites，
他绝对不是在宣泄自己的愤怒
，He's not venting his anger，
而是量身定做为他们
，It's measured and moderated for them，
想要让他们悔改
，Hoping for them to repent。
当然，我们世上也有一些不负责的父母们。
And of course, we do have irresponsible parents.
恐怕我们当中也有，你我都同在当中。
We might be among them.
我们有时候在管教孩子的时候，我们其实在泄我们自己的愤。
That when we're disciplining our children, we might be venting our own anger.
但是我们的神绝对不是这样。
But our God is never like that.
神的管教都是有节制的。
God's discipline is controlled.
它是按照人的过犯恰到好处的。
It is moderated precisely according to man's misdeeds.
人绝对不会成为神泄愤的对象。
God will never vent its anger on man.
我们很惊奇地发现。
Here we will find in surprise.
神管教人是一层一层递进的。
That God's discipline for man is step by step.
但是在前面的章节里面。
But in the previous verses,
神祝福百姓的时候，却是恨不得把自己最好都给他们。
When God blesses His people, He gives everything without any reservation.
当百姓走在正路上的时候
，When His people are walking in the right path,
神给他们丰收
，God gives them harvest,
给他们平安
，give them peace,
给他们生养众多
，give them increase in number,
还要亲自与他们同住同行
，and God dwells and walks with them.
就像我们对我们的儿女。
Just as we how we treat our children.
他稍微乖一点的时候啊。
And as soon as they behave.
你恨不得把世上最好的东西都给他们。
You want to give everything, all the good things under the sun to them.
毫无保留。
Without any reservation.
我们看到神的管教。
We see God's discipline.
的确是为了挽回百姓。
It's for redeeming His people.
它不是一个惩罚。
This is not a punishment.
更不是一个泄愤。
It's not a vent.
我们来看最后一部分，四十到四十六节。
Let's see the last part, verse 40 to 46.
守约是慈爱。
Faithfulness and mercifulness.
如果我们知道一些以色列的历史
，If we know a little bit about the Israelite history，
就像我刚才所说的
，Like I just said，
以色列百姓的确是一而再、再而三的悖逆神。
The Israelite people sinned, on God over and over again.
他们一次一次被管教。
They were disciplined more and more severely.
他们的管教一次比一次严重。
And every discipline was more and more severe.
直到最后。
And till the end.
他们接受到了终极的管教。
They received the ultimate discipline.
百姓们被抓被掳到巴比伦。
The people were killed and kidnapped to Babylon.
就像圣经里所说的，被仇敌吞灭。
It's as the Bible described that they were devoured by their enemies.
在人看来。
In men's eyes.
以色列民族的历史应该就到此为止了。
The Israelite history should have ended here.
历史上有很多民族。
There are quite few nations in history.
因着战乱，因着饥荒。
Due to war and famine.
就消失在历史的长河里了。
They became extinct.
但是我们看到。
But here we see.
以色列民族的故事并没有到此为止。
The Israelite story did not end here.
神在四十节开始给我们了一个预言。
In verse 40, God gave a prophecy.
神说他们要承认自己的罪和他们祖宗的罪，他们未受割礼的心若谦卑了，他们也服了罪孽的刑罚。
If they confess their iniquities and the iniquities of their father and their treasury that they committed against me, and also in walking contrary to me, and if their uncircumcised heart is humbled and they make amends for their iniquity.
四十二节说。
And verse 42.
我就要纪念我与雅各所立的约，与以撒所立的约，与亚伯拉罕所立的约，并要纪念之地。
I will remember my covenant with Jacob, and I will remember my covenant with Isaac, and my covenant with Abraham, and I will remember the land.
天哪，这样一个造天地的神。
This God who created heaven and earth.
在以色列百姓一而再、再而三地背逆他以后。
After the Israelites have sinned and transgressed against him over and over again.
在这些百姓接受他们最终的惩罚了以后。
After these people have received their ultimate discipline.
神还在这里等待他们认罪悔改。
God is still here waiting for them to repent.
神还要继续的祝福他们。
God is here trying to bless them.
神要纪念他们。
God will remember them.
因为他与以色列祖宗所立的约。
Because God has made a covenant with the Israelite ancestors.
这真的是一个守约的神。
This is a God who keeps his promises.
四十四节说道。
In verse 44,
虽是这样，他们在仇敌之地，我却不厌弃他们，也不厌恶他们，将他们进行灭绝，也不背弃我与他们所立的约，因为我是耶和华他们的神。
Yet for all that, when they're in the land of their enemies, I will not spurn them, neither will I abhor them so as to destroy them utterly and break my covenant with them, for I am their God.
他是耶和华。
He is Jehovah.
就算百姓在仇敌之地，他还要纪念他们。
Even when his people are in the land of enemies, he will remember them.
弟兄姊妹，你知道这是什么是一个什么样的概念吗
？Brothers, sisters, do you understand what this concept?
就像你跟别人签了一个合约。
You have, it's almost like you signed a contract with someone.
你一而再、再而三的违约。
And you keep on breaching this contract.
对方呢，一而再、再而三的给你机会。
And that person keeps on giving you opportunities.
希望你能够认识到自己违约的错误。
And hoping you would see your fault in breaching the contract.
希望你能够回到履行合约的光景当中。
And so that you would come back and resume your duties under the contract.
可是你还是违约。
But you keep on breaching it.
到了最后，你被告上法庭。
And in the end, you are sued in court.
被判刑入狱。
And you are sentenced guilty and jailed.
原本故事就这样结束了。
And the story could have ended here.
那个告你的人可以拍拍屁股就走了。
The plaintiff could just get up and leave.
可是他却找人捎话告诉你说。
But he finds someone to come and tell you.
只要你认罪悔改。
As long as you confess and repent.
等你从监狱里出来了，我还要履行那份合约。
When you come out of jail, I will still commit to the contract.
因为我们有约在先。
Because we had a contract.
我们的神就是这样一位守约施慈爱的神。
Our God is this God full of faithfulness and mercifulness.
亲爱的弟兄姊妹们
，Dear brothers and sisters，
我们现在的基督徒和那个时候的百姓又有什么区别呢
？How is our modern-day Christian different from those Israelites？
我们也悖逆。
We are also disobedient.
我们有时候离弃神。
We also transgress against God.
我们不纪念神让他儿子在十字架上。为我们所成就的救恩。
We do not remember the salvation that God's Son has accomplished for us on the cross.
就算是这样。
And even so.
神充满了慈爱，定义要爱我们。
God is full of mercy and he is committed to loving us.
他说你们只要认罪悔改。
He said as soon as you confess and repent.
他就要纪念我们。
He will remember us.
在今生，在永恒。
In this lifetime and also in eternity.
我们看到人使用如果的时候呢，都是一个有条件的用法。
We see that when we use the word if, it's a conditional use.
但是神却用着利未记二十六章。
But God uses Leviticus chapter 26.
向我们用如果展示了他无条件的爱。
He used the word if to show his unconditional love.
如果人顺服他。
If man obeys him.
他就要赐福给人。
He will bless them.
如果人悖逆。
If man disobeys.
他还是要赐福。
He will still bless.
他会一次一次的 给人悔改的机会。
He will keep on giving opportunities to repent.
他要人回头。
He wants men to repent.
他要人回到他的面前。
He wants men to return before him.
这就是神的恩上加恩。
This is truly grace upon grace.
无论是顺服还是悖逆。
No matter it's obedient or disobedient.
神的目的是要把人带到他的面前。
God's goal is to bring men into eternity.
使人可以活在他的面光当中。
So that men can live before him in his presence.
我们要问自己。
We must ask ourselves.
天下哪有这等的好事啊？
How could there be such a wonderful thing?
但是也许。
But perhaps.
也许因为他是耶和华。
Because he is Jehovah.
他是永远的神。
He is God forever.
单单因着他的所事
simply because of who he is,
天下就有这样的好事
and such good things is possible.
我们一起来低头祷告
Let's pray together.
主，我们感谢你
Lord, we thank you.
你实在是位有恩典的主
Lord, you're full of grace.
你赐给我们今天你的话语
You gave us your words today.
让我们看到我们无论在何时
Let us see that no matter where we are,
你都要赐福给我们
You want to bless us.
你要我们回到你的
You want us to return before you.
求你继续加添给我们力量。
Please add strength to us.
让我们常常行在你的光中。
So that we can walk in your presence.
我们这样祷告，奉主耶稣基督的名求。
We pray in Christ's name. Amen.